welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from John Russell and Anna Mateo. Later, Brian Lynn presents this week's Science Report. Finally, we continue our national parks journey with a visit to Colorado's Black Canyon of the Gunnison. But first,
the United States Navy has recently deployed new long-range air-to-air missiles in the Indo-Pacific area. The move could take away China's lead in the area, experts say. The AIM-174B is the longest-range air-to-air missile the U.S. has ever fielded. Its deployment was officially acknowledged in July. The AIM-174B can fly several times farther than the next best U.S. missile, the AIM-120. The AIM-174B does not require new production lines to manufacture, and it works with the aircraft of at least one ally, Australia. The AIM-174B, which can attack aerial targets as far away as 400 kilometers, has a longer range than China's PL-15 missile. The greater range permits U.S. jets to keep threats farther from aircraft carriers. The missile can also safely strike high-value targets, such as command and control planes, from a greater distance. Xia Cheng is a researcher at the Association of Strategic Foresight, a Taipei-based research group. Cheng said, "The United States can ensure the safety of their important assets, such as carrier groups, and launch long-range strikes on PLA targets." PLA stands for People's Liberation Army, China's military force. The existing long-range missile for U.S. aircraft, the AIM-120, has a top range of about 150 kilometers. Such a range requires the launching aircraft to fly deeper into disputed territory. As a result, aircraft carriers are at greater risk of anti-ship attacks. Any kind of conflict in the area means the U.S. Navy would have to operate within a few hundred kilometers of its Chinese adversary. Supporting Taiwan in an invasion would pull the Navy in even closer. The AIM-174B changes that situation. A senior U.S. defense technical expert told Reuters, "The big thing is that it lets the United States push in a little bit further into the South China Sea during a conflict." The expert, who declined to be named, added, "And it's going to potentially change Chinese behavior because it's going to hold large, slow aircraft at greater risk." The AIM-174B uses Raytheon's SM-6 missile design. Raytheon declined to comment on how many AIM-174Bs would be produced or if existing SM-6s would be converted. The new AIM-174Bs have been shown on U.S. Navy F-A-18EF Super Hornet aircraft, which are operated by both American and Australian militaries. Australia's defense ministry said it works closely with the U.S. to understand capability options available for Australian consideration. The U.S. Navy said the missile was operationally deployed, but it declined to comment on whether the AIM-174B would be supplied to allies, whether the AIM-174B would be put onto other aircraft, and how many AIM-174Bs it wanted each year. I'm John Russell.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. After 13 years of marriage, Bethany Miola admits that she and her husband can get caught up in their busy lives. They are raising 3 children, and they both have careers. So they make sure to take time every day for a 6-second kiss. The 6-second kiss is a daily exercise suggested by couples therapists John and Julie Gottman. It is as simple as it sounds. They say taking time each day for a 6-second kiss can help connect you physically and emotionally with your partner. It's kind of a funny thing to put on the to-do list, Miola said. She first learned of the exercise while studying for a master's degree that centered on marriage and family. It made a difference, Miola said. It's long enough to kind of ground you and say, here's this other person that I love, that I've committed to. Married in 1987, Julie and John Gottman co-founded the Gottman Institute to teach couples therapy. John Gottman also wrote The 7 Principles for Making Marriage Work and other books. John Gottman told the Associated Press that 6 seconds is not just a number. It comes from studying more than 3,000 couples over 30 years. The Gottmans found that a 6-second kiss is enough to help release oxytocin. Oxytocin is a natural substance that is produced by the body. The substance is widely believed to help a mother connect with her newborn baby. The Gottmans say it also builds trust in a relationship by calming down the fear center of the brain. They also used research by neuroeconomist Paul Zak. Zak suggests that a 20-second hug creates the same results. For the 20-second hug, or the 6-second kiss, it's one that really feels different. It feels like you've come home, John Gottman said. Julie Gottman said a long kiss works best for couples who are committed to each other and who trust each other. Couples who are working through personal or marital issues might not be ready for it. But how do you start this type of exercise? Couples have to decide to take time out of their day to put their relationship first. One partner might open the discussion by saying they believe the exercise could bring them closer and it is worth a try. The experts suggest creating a ritual. For example, set aside the same time every day when both are about to leave for work or just before bedtime. Creating a ritual prevents a relationship from becoming one in which the only thing a couple does together is add things to their very long list of tasks, John Gottman said. We really want to nurture the romance. Rituals also create a shared sense of purpose, Julie Gottman said. However, she reminds people to enjoy it. Do not think of it as something you are supposed to do. And to the couples who say they cannot find the time, she is direct and honest. You really don't have 6 seconds? You know we're not talking 6 hours here. We're talking 6 seconds, she said with a laugh. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
A new study provides evidence that Mars contains a large ocean deep beneath its surface. The finding is based on data collected by the InSight lander, a robotic explorer operated by the American Space Agency, NASA. InSight, which landed in 2018, was designed to capture data from within the planet's interior. The lander ended its operations on Mars in late 2022. For the current study, researchers used seismic data collected by InSight. The team examined the data to study Martian quake activity. Seismic activity on Mars happens in the form of Mars quakes. NASA says InSight had recorded more than 1,300 Mars quakes. The device InSight uses to measure ground movements is called a seismometer. NASA specially designed the lander and its instruments to be extremely sensitive for the Martian environment. The seismic data suggests liquid water exists deep beneath the ground where InSight operated from. Since water is considered necessary to support life, scientists say the presence of it on Mars leaves open the possibility that some form of life might exist or existed there in the past. Numerous past studies have also provided evidence that liquid water could exist on Mars. Scientists have already uncovered evidence that about 3 billion years ago, the surface of Mars likely had an active system of lakes, rivers, and oceans. Mars is believed to have lost its surface water as its atmosphere thinned. This likely turned the planet into the dry, dusty world it is today. Scientists have theorized that much of the ancient water escaped out into space or remained buried under the surface. Vashon Wright is an assistant professor of geophysics at the University of California, San Diego's Scripps Institution of Oceanography. He helped lead the research. Wright told the Associated Press the data suggests liquid water sits between 11 to 20 kilometers down in the Martian crust. He added that the water likely moved down from the surface billions of years ago when water is believed to have flowed freely on Mars. The researchers combined computer models with the seismic data collected by InSight to reach their findings. They said the data showed the water is likely contained in a deep layer of igneous rock beneath the Martian surface. Igneous rock is formed from magma, a very hot liquid rock that has cooled. Wright and his team recently reported their results in a study published in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. In a statement to Reuters news agency, Wright said, "On Earth, what we know is where it is wet enough and there are enough sources of energy there is microbial life very deep in Earth's subsurface. He added that the data suggests the ingredients for life as we know it may exist in the Martian subsurface. The researchers said the InSight lander operated around the planet's Elysium Planitia area near the equator. They believe the area is representative of the rest of Mars. The study suggests enough water exists below the surface to form a planet-wide ocean about 1 to 2 kilometers deep. There is currently no way to confirm the study's suggested existence of liquid water because it sits so far beneath the Martian surface. Such a confirmation would require large drills and other specialized equipment. But Wright said in a statement that for now, researchers can use the newly examined data to gain a better understanding of Martian water cycles. This can help scientists improve their knowledge about the planet's climate, as well as the development of the Martian surface and interior. Wright noted the latest findings could also help guide researchers in where to look for further evidence of possible life forms on Mars. "I'm inspired, and I hope the public is also inspired," Wright said about the study results. "Humans can work together to put instruments on a planet and try to understand what's going on there." I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Ashley. Glad to be here.
This week, you reported on a new study suggesting Mars could have a very large underground ocean. How does this study differ from others also providing evidence of water on Mars?
Yes, this one was different in several ways. Most studies I'm aware of published in recent years have centered on evidence that water existed on Mars in the very distant past, up to 3 billion years ago. The rovers operated by NASA on Mars have collected data supporting this, and several areas explored so far showed clear signs that Mars once had very active water systems. But this study presents evidence of water currently on Mars.
And the fact that this study provides strong evidence of liquid water, as opposed to water in ice form, is also new, correct?
Yes, that's right. This study does leave open the possibility that this water is in liquid form. Many previous studies have not predicted this. For example, another study from early this year provided new evidence of a large amount of water buried near the planet's equator. But all this water is thought to be in the form of ice. That research was carried out in another area of Mars with data collected by an explorer operated by the European Space Agency. But that team predicted that underground water supply was quite large, possibly enough water to cover the entire Martian surface to a depth of up to 3 meters.
Okay, thanks again for joining me on the podcast, Bryan.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
Our national parks journey takes us to the western state of Colorado. There, you will find a 77-kilometer-long canyon. Its exposed rocks are among the oldest you will find on Earth. The canyon is so narrow and so deep that sunlight shines only briefly at the bottom at midday. That frequent darkness is what has given this canyon its name. Welcome to Black Canyon of the Gunnison National Park.
Black Canyon seems impossibly steep and narrow. The fast-moving Gunnison River formed the canyon over millions of years. As the river flows through the canyon, it drops an average of 18 meters per kilometer. The Gunnison River loses more elevation in its 77-kilometer canyon stretch than the Mississippi River does in 2,400 kilometers from Minnesota to the Gulf of Mexico. This loss in elevation causes the river to gain speed and force. Over time, that force has carved and cut the hard rock and created the wild and jagged rock formations found at Black Canyon. That process is known as erosion.
Black Canyon attracted little attention from early Western explorers. In fact, no early Spanish explorers to the southwestern United States reported seeing Black Canyon. The first written record about the canyon came in 1873. The Ute Indians certainly knew of Black Canyon, but only its rim, never the gorge, shows evidence of past human occupation. Even today, the depth and steepness of Black Canyon make it extremely difficult for humans to access.
Birds, however, have no problem surviving in the canyon environment. Black Canyon is home to many kinds of birds. They live at the canyon rim, along its walls, and by the river. Mountain bluebirds and great horned owls live in the rim area. The owls eat seeds and berries from the pinyon, juniper, and oak trees found there. Canyon wrens sing loudly within Black Canyon. Visitors are more likely to hear the birds than see them. They build their nests on flat surfaces of the canyon walls. So do peregrine falcons. They prey on other birds. They dive at speeds up to 300 kilometers per hour to catch them. American dippers build their nests in the gorge next to the Gunnison River. A gorge is a narrow valley between hills or mountains. These dippers feed on insects and small fish.
Some people come to Black Canyon of the Gunnison National Park for world-class bird watching. But it is the canyon itself that appeals to most visitors. Walking along the rim, seeing the canyon's towering cliffs, and hearing the powerful flow of the Gunnison River far below is an overwhelming experience. At Black Canyon, visitors can view some of the planet's oldest exposed rocks. They are Precambrian rocks. Precambrian accounts for the Earth's history from its very beginning up until about 540 million years ago. Precambrian rocks are described as basement rocks because they are usually buried deep under the surface. They only become exposed when younger rocks have been cut away by erosion or other forces. At Black Canyon, the Gunnison has eroded the canyon walls so greatly that Precambrian rocks have become visible. Often, the canyon's rock walls look like works of art. Different kinds of rocks fold together and form colorful patterns. The patterns change as sunlight hits different parts of the walls. One area of the canyon is known as Painted Wall. It is the highest cliff in Colorado. Long pink bands of rock cover this section of the canyon, as if a person took a paintbrush to the wall. This pattern formed as hot liquid from below the Earth's surface forced its way into rock cracks. As it slowly cooled, large crystals formed. The bands get their pink color from a crystallized mineral called potassium feldspar.
Local people knew just how special Black Canyon was. They began urging Congress to protect the canyon in the 1930s. It became a national monument in 1933. And in 1999, it became a national park. The park protects more than 22 kilometers of the canyon. Most visitors spend their time exploring the canyon rim by foot or by car. Several kilometers of trails lead to many overlook points. A road also leads to several breathtaking views. The U.S. Congress named the lands below the canyon rim a wilderness preservation system. This is meant to protect forever the land's natural conditions.
Some adventurous travelers choose to explore this wilderness by hiking down to the inner canyon. There are no marked trails to guide them. Hikers must first get a wilderness use permit. These permits are free, but only a limited number are available each day. Many of the paths are difficult to follow. Some are also dangerous. The Warner Point Trail, for example, drops more than 820 meters. Walking down takes more than 2 hours. Walking back up can take up to 4 hours. The Park Service warns that poison ivy grows wildly in the inner canyon. There is also the risk of falling rocks. But to reach a place where no humans ever tried to live is the reward. In the words of a 1901 explorer to Black Canyon's river area, "Our surroundings were of the wildest possible description. The roar of the water was constantly in our ears. Occasionally, a rock would fall from one side or the other with a roar and a crash, exploding like a ton of dynamite when it struck bottom, making us think our last day had come." I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.